Hey there, welcome to Table to Stage. I'm Jordan Werma, and this is my podcast, my continuing mission to explore creativity through the stories and experiences of creators everywhere. Today, we're going to hear from two incredible musicians, Hannah and Andy of the band Sodada. They are based in Massachusetts. They have New York roots, and I dig it. I caught up with Hannah and Andy in their kitchen, and we talked about their influences, processes, and trails of breadcrumbs. And we covered a lot more. It was really great, and I hope you enjoy it. Now, don't forget to leave a rating and a review of Table to Stage over at Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. Ratings make it easier for new listeners to find the show and to spread the word about all the amazing creators we have in the area. You can also email tabletostage@gmail.com if you have any questions or comments about the show, and I read them all, so go ahead and send them. All right, without further delay, here are Hannah and Andy of the band Sodada.
From Croton-on-Hudson, very, very small town on the river.
I'm from Mayapac in Putnam County, a little further north.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And how did you guys meet?
Breadcrumbs.
Breadcrumbs. Really? That's a thing. Huh?
I mean, yeah. If you look back, there's just like so many different choices I could have made in my life and we would not have met each other, which is interesting. I actually dropped out of Emerson College and then took a semester off, went to Hunter College, and there I was taking choir and made a friend there who happened to know Andy just through some other random connections. And we kind of went up once. She and I were working on music, and then we went up to record and hang out at Andy's one time.
And I guess I knew that person through a friend that happened to be going to SUNY Purchase, and we just like all ended up there at the same time.
And really good friends with each other.
Yeah.
But weirdly, we had met once when we were like 16 and didn't get along and then never met again. But I didn't really remember.
Really? So you met earlier and then came back together later on?
Yeah. Yeah. Which is pretty interesting.
How did that work?
Breadcrumbs.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, but do you remember meeting each other that first time?
Not really.
No?
I don't really remember it, but Andy does, and it sounds like it would be me.
All right.
We can have very clashing personalities, which works really well as adults because we can have like, we can work through things, and actually it ends up being quite productive in that we both come from very different places and ideas a lot of the time. I think, you know, being
at 16, I was the bad kid and
I was a goody two shoes a little bit.
So okay.
Yeah.
So oil and vinegar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, as far as like when you guys got together, did you know that you were both musicians at the time? Were you both interested? How did you work that relationship out?
We've both been playing since we were small.
Yeah,
and I guess the first time we hung out as adults, the aim was to have a recording session.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
so you actually had intention
to work
right from the get go.
Yeah.
Okay.
We ended up playing music for like 9 hours with our friends Pam and Richie who were there. And
You know, at first it was more of just like, you know, we both had a friend of a friend and we were just going to get together and see what happened. And then 10 hours later, there was a band.
It was just in a kind of immediate, immediate click there and just being like, wow, well, this was really supposed to happen. We were supposed to come together. Like really felt like the four of us that night, we were like, this is crazy that this is happening right now. It really felt much bigger, but we kind of very quickly started that band, at the time, which was like almost exactly 7 years ago. And then kind of we just ended up ultimately moving up here to Massachusetts about 4 years ago. And it's been really great. That's kind of when we decided to essentially rebrand as Sodada. We had been taking about a year and a half off from shows to work on this album. Our first album is Sodada, called If You Woke Me. And part of that process was that we really wanted to we started to see a new sound emerging. Mm-hmm. We had actually recorded like a 15 song album. We saw a new sound emerging and we were like, we really want to refine this and take it really in this direction. It felt like the first time we had a clear direction of, you know, a sound that we wanted to go into, I think. Huh.
Those 15 songs you recorded, was that as Sodada, or was that with the previous iteration?
It was a previous iteration.
Okay.
It was basically us and our friend Nick. We were the Pink Tacos. It was back when we still lived in New York. that was a fun band, but it was a little more of like a soul retro vibe kind of thing. And I think during the course of this album, we started to see more of like this jazz and hip hop influences coming through, and that was really inspiring to us. And we were happening to be moving at the same time. So we kind of used that as to, let's step back from gigs. Let's take a break. Let's really start figuring out, you know, where we have a few songs from this album that we think really fit the sound. The rest of them are to be determined later on.
Yeah. But
we just kind of were like, let's take these few songs that we really started to hear the sound emerging in and all these new influences that we're having. At the time, we had just heard Sound and Color by Alabama Shakes. A new world hangs outside the window, beautiful and strange. It must be found in a way. I must be. Sound and color. And that was incredibly inspirational. And eye-opening.
We heard that and started like heavily listening to Erykah Badu at the same time.
Yeah, oh, okay. So we were like, yeah, we need to step up our game. We need to. It wasn't like we were trying to sound like anybody, but we just had all these new things to listen to that were.
Really, and they sort of just like lit a fire to just push ourselves to do better.
Do you know what it was about that music at that time that was such an inspiration for you?
We were kind of like going through a lot, I think. And I think we had had a pretty bad show at one time. And we were like, okay, we want to try to hone our live sound. And that kind of was making us just think about everything, what we were doing. And part of that was like, we had, as I was saying earlier before we were on tape, but I was saying we have a very wide ranging influences, both of us. And I think both of us, and say this if I'm speaking for both of us, are always looking for new music. And when we hear something new, we kind of obsess over it and listen to an album over and over again. And I think we had just listened, Sound and Color in particular, I was just kind of blown away by the arrangements and the songs themselves, and starting to think about in the studio, what are different new sounds we can get? Andy, you were starting to, that's when you're starting to really start building audio equipment in a very serious way, which you built some stuff that really stepped up the recording game.
What kind of stuff were you building?
Oh, I still, when I'm not playing music or working on other people's records, I build mic pre's and microphones and compressors.
Really?
And controllers and EQs. And,
oh, geez.
Yeah.
Okay, a little bit of light engineering.
Most of our record is recorded on custom equipment.
Oh,
yeah. I've always been into it, but yeah, that was right around when I was starting to like not just be guessing.
Yeah.
Okay.
And there's something about a big move, like physically moving to a new place, that adds this sort of dynamicism in your life. I feel like that was a very big move for both of us.
The move up to Massachusetts.
Yeah, up to Massachusetts in a lot of ways. And part of that was, it was really, for me, the first time I had moved somewhere not for, like, school or something like that. It was just really, we used to visit Andy's mom up here a lot and really loved the area. We had a couple friends up here and just got a really good sense of the music and art scene. And just, it seemed like a really good place to live. And it actually really has lived up to that. It's been just wonderful to be here, but
great place to come home to.
Yeah. And that, but you know, taking that chance, I didn't actually have a job lined up or anything. And you are self-employed, so you were kind of just doing whatever you were doing. And it was just a big leap of faith. But I think during that time, it was inspiring a lot of writing to happening, like the months before that, the summer before that move. And I think that just a lot of new songs were born during that.
What was it when you're younger, you're growing up, what was the spark for you that got you into music in such a way that you wanted to start creating your own?
You go first.
Well, so I grew up around music. When I was really little, both my parents were recording engineers. My mom does other stuff now, but we're actually just finishing up a record with her.
Oh.
So she does other stuff for a living.
But okay.
but and my dad isn't around anymore, but he was also a recording engineer and all around audio person. So I come by it honestly in that sense. But thinking about how my mom does other stuff now, but we're still making a record, brings me around to the point that I want to make, is that for me, and I'm going to quote a friend on this, I feel like art is just like vomit. It's something inside you that needs to come out.
And Carson Satterfield quote, everybody.
Lonely Whale music, Carson Satterfield, art is vomit. It needs to come out. It's something trapped inside you that is going to come out whether you like it or not. But really though, I mean, it's something that, It's an interesting thing sort of interacting with folks as an artist, especially I have so many friends that are artists in one way or another that I forget that not everybody does that. But it's
that's interesting.
But it's like a compulsion. It's who you are. It's something that's always with you, something that's always there. It's an act, a conscious decision to make it a predominant focus and priority in your life. Mm-hmm. But there was never a decision to start making art. That's just always been there. Because it's more of a need than anything.
Yeah.
I guess similarly for me, my dad is a really incredible painter, and my mom's a very creative person, if not, you know, necessarily creating art actively. But I grew up in a very artistic household, and supposedly when I was a baby, my mom said I had to have music playing to be able to fall asleep. And I think my first words were Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. So I was constantly,
really?
Yeah. And I, from the time I was like very, very tiny, I was doing dance, like ballet and stuff and theater. I was very, very big into theater for most of my life. And I started playing piano when I was 4. But mostly what I was really interested in was actually acting. And that's when I went to Emerson College, I was actually going for theater originally. Mm-hmm. And I really wanted to do, you know, more, I loved musicals. I loved Shakespeare, stuff like that. But I think that kind of getting that performance element, the love of the stage really has fed into the music stuff. And, you know, I always used to, if I was upset or anything, I always used to just run over to the piano and play, but I mostly just did classical stuff. When I started really writing my own, I taught myself guitar when I was 14, and then when I was like 18, I think just towards the end of high school, dealing with like stupid, you know, at the time relationship stuff, I just have a memory of like the first song I wrote being up till 4 a.m, secretly smoking a cigarette in my closet so my parents wouldn't smell it, and just like writing this song, which looking back is definitely not the best thing I've ever written in my life, but I did write a lot of poetry through high school, so I think what I did at the time was, like, I was feeling a lot. I took a poem and just put basic chords to it on the guitar, and I think just over... I worked with some other people writing, collaborating sometimes, but I think really until probably about when I left Emerson, you know, for me, part of that was I had been playing music with somebody there, and I just realized that all I really wanted to be doing was sitting in the park and playing music. So why was I paying so much for tuition to be just wanting to do this thing and not being involved with theater there, and moving home and not having anything to do besides just play music for like 12 hours a day. And over that time, I did a lot of writing and just realizing, like, kind of over the course of that following year, that this was really what I was supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
And it was kind of clear to me that all along this was what I should be doing.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like both of you had sort of that same drive right from the get-go.
Yeah.
That's why we connected so much, I think, because when we first met, it's kind of at the crux of that. I think we both instantly recognized in the other that we had this purpose, sense of purpose around music and just creating music. So I think that was just kind of what's kept us at it.
For sure.
Doing this all these years.
Yeah. What kind of music were you surrounded by or listening to while you're growing up?
Everything.
I guess me too.
Everything. I guess when I was really little, just tons of classic rock and soul and R&B and mm-hmm. funk. And then, but I mean, also weird experimental stuff too, and just all sorts of stuff. I mean, having parents that were both musicians and recording engineers, so it was just a similar thing of the musician eclectic taste thing.
Right.
It's just records from everyone all over the place. And somewhere along the lines, I got really interested in like 70s punk rock.
Okay.
And
I
I picked up on that listening to your your record. Was that there's a 70s, there's definitely a 70s influence in there.
Well, yeah, and I mean, and from more than one thing stylistically, but it was interesting actually, because when we sort of went about the Sodada rebrand, one of the things too, because we were incorporating new influences for sure, but we were also opening ourselves back up to some more heavy sounds, which was, I think, actually sort of coming back to stylistic things we had been interested in, because the first band we were in actually was almost more of like a folk rock thing. It was like way more acoustic,
like indie and folk rock kind of
light and laid back and stuff.
Yeah.
So it's been interesting in the past couple of projects to be like, you know, this just really wants a really distorted guitar right here, and let's go for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had kind of a similar upbringing, and our parents are in the same age group, so I think they listen to a lot and kind of grew up in similar areas also. So they had a lot of similar influences. My dad is hugely into the Beatles, so I've always been hugely into the Beatles as well, which is something that he and I share. And actually, around like the first year or so of Andy and I being in a band, I was lucky enough to take a Beatles class at Hunter College, which was probably the coolest thing. It was basically a mix of like music history, production and recording techniques and songwriting and music theory using the context of the Beatles. And it was really, really inspirational to really get to dive deeper into that, I suppose. But, you know, I grew up watching Yellow Submarine. I think past that, it took me a little while to really get into a lot of my parents' music. I mean, they played stuff that we could all listen to in the car, like Sweet Honey and the Rock. And they had this Jerry Garcia tape that said "Not Just for Kids" or something like that. So they had, it was basically children's songs, kind of acoustic, but that adults could enjoy as well.
Yeah.
And then I think I kind of was just really into pop music for a long time. My first CD I ever had was Backstreet Boys Millennium, and I loved that. And I loved a lot of just kind of like, probably not stuff I'd listen to now, but I remember being in sixth grade, I got very, very into Avril Lavigne, Vanessa Carlton, and Michelle Branch, and I kind of saw those three as like very big influences for me at the time.
Well, it was a 2-week period where they ruled the world.
Yeah, they were great, and honestly, Avril Lavigne's first album was fire. And I was actually checking out, I was curious, what was Vanessa Carlton up to these days, and she's doing some really cool stuff.
Yeah.
Still, and really just, actually, she in particular was a huge influence because of the piano playing. So, mm-hmm. you know, I of course learned 1,000 Miles and everything, but it's, I think I did a lot of self-exploration, especially when the internet came out.
When they came out with the internet.
Yeah, when that thing came out. But it was really nice. Like, I used to spend a lot of time in college just like on music blogs all the time, and just mostly with other people would give me. I had some friends and a boyfriend in high school who just kind of gave me a lot of music to listen to. Mm-hmm. And that was a lot. And then I think at that time I kind of came back and realized my parents had a great taste in music all along and I should have just been listening to their music.
Yeah, I came to that a little bit later in life too.
Yeah.
The bands that you've been in together, the previous iteration and now with Sodada, are you conscious of the influences, the specific influences on the sound that you're putting together right now? Or is it more of a background thing?
To the vibe of what we're working on in particular?
Yeah, like are you consciously aware of the different bands that kind of influence the sound?
I mean, in sometimes. A sense, yeah. In a sense, you know, maybe we'll hear a record and be like, oh, that's a really cool kick drum sound.
Mm-hmm.
Or like, we really like how that bass tone, you know?
That synth sound, oh man.
Yeah, like but the point being, like, maybe there's an element here or there, but otherwise I'd say it's really an amalgamation.
Yeah.
It's Sodada to me feels the most like us out of everything, whereas I'd say in the previous iterations it would be easier to say, you know, these are sort of the things that we're going for, whereas what felt like started to happen with the music that became Sodada was it really started to feel like we were finding our own voice.
Yeah.
And so sure, you can hear influences in it, but we're not sitting down and going, you know, and this is going to be the Stones song or,
right.
you know, or
right,
whatever.
Right, right.
There is a song called Pop Song in D Major, but it never made it onto the record.
No, it did never make it onto the record.
Well, okay. So you mentioned before you had an album recorded with 15 songs.
Mm-hmm. And you took
three of them
yeah.
and sort of put a new sound to them.
Yeah. It was
Ultra Violet actually was one of them.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Thank you. Records to this one, because we had
the ones
in particular from this one that ended up on If You Woke Me were If You Woke Me, Rain, Frequency, and
If You Woke Me wasn't a song yet.
It wasn't. That was just inspired by the sound. So Rain and A Thought were the two that we had from that record, I guess, of the 15 songs. And
We've taken pieces of other ones too.
Okay. Yeah, right. Oh, yeah, we have taken pieces.
On our new record Phase, there's a song called Lit Up, and the outro of Lit Up is actually the verse of an old song that we didn't end up pursuing that song, but sort of took little pieces to collage. And
I may like to come back to that at some point, though.
Yeah, maybe.
Cool.
Well, I was just interested because if you've got 15 songs recorded, that means you had 15 songs you were happy enough with that you could put them down and really have a concrete result.
Sometimes and then you need to hear them back to not be happy
with
them. Yeah,
but then to take 12 of them and just sort of discard them.
They're shelved.
I imagine there's got to be some heartache involved.
I'm really good at this.
Andy's really good at closing themselves off.
I have no problem with, I know for some folks there's a certain reverence for a thing being created, like I made this, so I have to honor it.
Mm-hmm.
I am on the complete opposite end of the spectrum with I made this and I can do whatever I want with it, and that either means I can pursue it or I can never play it again, and that's fine.
You've taught me that about that a lot, because I'm somebody that I'm very sentimental. It's really hard for me to let go of things. And I wouldn't say that these songs are discarded so much as shelved, because actually I have plans to do a solo record in coming up sometime.
Okay.
When I get to it. But basically, Andy's still going to be involved in the production and bass playing capacity. But a lot of those songs are actually, some of them are ones I'm going to take for that. Because they're great. Actually, it has nothing to do with the songs. It was more like we started, I think we always had this kind of, I wouldn't necessarily say a problem. We always sounded like five different bands. Even when it was just the two of us writing, because our first band, there was a third songwriter. So naturally it sounded like a bunch of different bands. But even when our second kind of project, the Pink Tacos, was the two of us writing,
The big difference was that was still very much, one of us writing a song and bringing it to the other person and saying, let's work on this together. Whereas Sodada, we really started writing together.
Okay. So this is a collaborative songwriting process too. Okay.
Yeah. And I mean, part of the reason I'm doing a solo thing is because I kind of miss having some things that are my own in a sense, or just the accomplishment, feeling of accomplishment of like finishing a song on your own can be really fulfilling.
Also nice as an artist to have your own outlet.
For sure.
It's awesome to do the collaborative thing, and it's really cool to still be an individual.
Yeah. Both can exist at once. It's great. Yeah. But something that I think was
amazing
was going on with that, and we started to realize was, and actually due to a comment from an industry professional at a show of ours, which was very enlightening and a kick in the butt for us, was it really, what were we trying to sound like? And I think that is something that is a challenge that comes with having really diverse taste in music, because naturally you're going to have songs that just sound like all different kinds of things.
Yeah.
And I don't see that as a bad thing, but for instance, being on all in one record, it could be something like the White Album, where it's essentially, like
a ploy to get out of a contract.
Yeah. Right. Not that we were in a contract or anything, but like,
and the White Album is one of my favorite records.
But
anyhow.
Great, but something that is just basically a mix of a whole bunch of different styles, amalgamation of different styles. And I think what we were kind of wanting was to have something as a little bit more cohesive, at least as far as a piece of work such as an album goes.
Right.
With the 15-song album, while fantastic, ranged from having something like an indie rock song to this weird like electronic jam that was awesome, but like
just had nothing to do with one another.
Those two didn't fit on an album.
I mean, and it's an interesting thing too, because I think that in terms of the finding the sound that became Sodada, a lot of it had to do with sort of, so like you hear something and it's inspiring and you're influenced by it, right? But you sort of need to internalize it in the sense where it can then mingle with all your other influences, because I guess in a sense, all art is derivative to some capacity, but to the point where something is really just an influence and just a very small piece in the large pool of all the little pieces of information that make our personalities individual mm-hmm. and what they are. So you sort of need to take that time for the influence to not just be, because you can just hear something and be inspired, but for something to really be an influence in, like, in that sense to me, it sort of takes time for it to be internalized and become part of that amalgamation. So you're not just spitting back what you heard. You're not, right. That sort of time, it's not plagiarism anymore. You know, not that anyone's like, not plagiarizing, just like copying the song, but being like, I'm going to try to write a song like this thing I heard, versus being like, oh yeah, this is just something in my subconscious, like that's making up my taste.
Where it might feel like something rather than sound like something, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or just where it can, it has time for a reaction to happen where what you're getting out isn't what you put in. Hmm. You know, so just to say where the point where you're not trying, like, so, well, I guess, yes, that doesn't sound like it, and rather something that feels like it, but, or that doesn't even necessarily call it to mind. I mean, I'm sure there's music I listen to that you wouldn't be able to call to mind from listening to our record, but they're still informing my decisions because mm-hmm. it's part of my taste.
Right.
Yeah,
that's interesting. So, way I put that.
So I think it was sort of an interesting period because that 15 song record, there was so much stuff that was new and exciting, and we were doing this and doing that because we were new and we were excited by all this new stuff. Whereas the Sodada stuff, some more time had passed, and we were able to incorporate that holistically into our sound, as opposed to being like, mm-hmm. I want to write a song like this. It's just like, oh, this is just something that's now informing where we're coming from.
Yeah. So the Sodada stuff, was this what you decided to actually record was all informed by a sound that you were going for, or a sound that came about naturally with the two of you playing, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, both for sure.
Hey everyone, Jordan here. Just breaking in for a moment to let you know that Chestnut Street Playhouse in Norwich, Connecticut is currently seeking director proposals for their 2020 main stage season. Chestnut Street Playhouse is looking for talented directors to bring a new season to life on their stage. If there's a show you've been dying to direct, maybe something special to you, that would be a great fit for the unique space that Chestnut Street provides, you still have time to get your submission in. Proposals for the 2020 season are being accepted until August 30th, so if you visit www.chestnutstreetplayhouse.org, you can download a copy of the application from the Work With Us tab. Now make sure you mention Table to Stage when submitting your application, and if you're selected, I'll be sure to be in the audience when the lights go up. All right, back to the show.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, something that's cool about doing all our own recording is that, first off, recording can really be a creative process. It doesn't just have to be documenting something. And second off, sort of piggyback off that is that the process of recording can inform what's recorded.
Sure.
So it doesn't have to be just, this is what we're going to record. It's like, okay, here's where we're going to start. And then it can be a real process where we let it shape where we go, and we let the music guide us, man.
Yeah.
These songs on this most recent album, we actually wrote them that way. We basically like demoed them in our house studio and just essentially layered over them until mm-hmm. they were the real thing.
Yeah, sort of, you know, we'd get all the instruments on and be like, okay, well, let's go back and do this guitar for real now and like, and replace parts. And that's sort of how we ended up with that record.
And then, you know, we ended up like redoing all the drums at one point, certain songs, somebody wanted to change the key many times, and
that was me.
So
process of elimination. Yeah, I figured that out.
And of course, like certain things, like some a friend of Andy's very, very generously lent us his synthesizer, a Prophet 6, which I had never gotten to play a synth to that quality before in my
life. It's like a really, really fancy polyphonic. And our friend Will also. That's what's all over making those crazy like big waves of sound.
Yeah, and I'm really grateful to both of them that two people lent us their Prophets, and I got to really get the chance to use that tool. And I feel like that made a huge difference with our sounds because, I mean, I have a micro Korg and I use that live usually, but, it's a digital synth. It's not the same as an analog synth. And, you know, just getting the chance to use the experience of our lives as we went along over 2 years and all the music that we were listening to over that time and all of the ways that we grew as people being incorporated gradually into these songs. So they weren't really the same as when we first started, which was pretty cool.
Yeah. Now, in terms of like the actual music, the instrumentation that you guys use, who's doing what? And I mean, because it sounds like there's a million of you on this record.
There are. So,
most of the bass, there's about 1.5 songs I'm not playing bass on. I'm playing a lot of guitar. I'm playing a little synthesizer and a little organ.
I'm singing. I'm playing mostly keys. Like anytime you hear a Fender Rhodes, that's or a piano. Yeah,
you're
that's
doing
me.
Like 99% of the keys.
Synthesizers, a Hammond organ. I'm playing a Mellotron on Ultraviolet, and then I'm playing guitar on Lit Up and Carry the Moon.
Then we had our drummer, Ted Sullivan, playing drums, and then Josh Hurst, who is one of the folks we have play bass with us live, played bass on the song Phase and on the clip that became Delta 7, which is a loop of Josh and our friend Ian jamming along to a little recording of guitar that I made with absolutely no idea what's going on. It's like, it ended up being the coolest part. Josh does this thing on the bass where he's like just touching it. If you solo it, it just doesn't really sound like music, but you loop it and you put it along with the drum beat and it's awesome. Huh. It's great. So there was that. And then
Carolina Leary is playing strings on Lit Up and Carry the Moon. And she's fantastic. She's being like the entire string ensemble. Playing violin, viola, and cello.
Not all at once.
She was such a good sport about that session. She was such a good sport. Yeah. Play this little one note and then this other little one note.
1,800 times. I think we have like 30 string tracks on that song.
Oh my God.
No, but it's probably 15 string tracks because it's 2 mics per track.
You had to cut a bunch of string tracks at one point. But
I just turned a bunch.
Or not cut, but.
No, I just turned a bunch of the one. I used mostly one of the mics.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Now, how does the recorded result of your music differ from a stage performance?
Well, people are just gonna have to come to our shows and hear. But
that's
really
what they call a tease.
Actually, that was it was a major thing when we had an album release show in May. So back the beginning of the year, we were like, crap, how are we gonna do this? Like, we have no idea how we're gonna pull this off.
Yeah.
Because part of it was that we had to, like, at least myself, relearn most of these songs because it had been so long. I'm like, I don't really know what part I was playing here, but more than that, I was like, what am I going to play? Because I can't, like, we already knew Andy was going to play guitar, but I also wanted to play guitar on some songs. But I also can't play all of the keys parts. It's just, you know, some people can do that. I'm not one of them. While I can multitask on singing and playing keyboards and whatever, but
Live when we can swing it, we have drums, bass, guitar, and that's my guitar, and then Hannah is on piano, synthesizer, and some guitar, and then we'll have another keyboard player who's playing Hammond organ and synthesizer.
Which is okay. Our friend Darby.
Yeah. We haven't attempted the strings live because a string player won't sound like the string arrangements. We'd need a quartet, and that's just the whole thing.
So we may have a friend who plays some gnarly guitar with pedals come do some experimenting with what that sounds like. You know,
I mean, places some of the synth and string parts.
Yeah, like when we can't have the synth player or can't have the... Actually, Darby literally brings an entire Hammond organ to shows with him with a Leslie cabinet. He's awesome.
He's a boss.
He really is a boss. He has it all in like a dolly.
He's great.
Wheelie thing. Yeah.
He's got it figured out.
It's very impressive.
But I mean, the songs though, like, we're not a jam band in the sense that, like, the songs are still the songs. Mm-hmm. The instrumentation might change slightly, but
it's still recognizable to the same song. Yeah.
Yeah, but you'd get a slightly different arrangement, slightly different things would pop out at you, slightly different things would happen. But to me, that's part of the excitement of a live show.
Yeah.
Is, you know, it's like, you still have to have the hook there. You still have to have the chorus so folks can sing along. But then, you know, maybe instead of a string solo, there's like
guitars
and organ doing something back and forth, or, you know, something just like little things changed here and there.
Yeah.
And I guess too, live, we, not loose as in, we tend to be a little looser about arrangements live, which can be fun. And just really, it's more of a live performance as opposed to a premeditated thing.
Yeah. So, I mean, you could have, what, 5 people on stage for a show then?
Sometimes 4. Sometimes we will do just a quartet with just bass and drums, and then Andy and I.
Yeah. And everything's still recognizable like that. It's just a little less space filled. But and sometimes that's better for the venue, you know?
Yeah.
Well, sometimes I adjust when I'm playing based on if there's another keyboard player. I won't do as much lead stuff, I suppose, on keys, which is actually really nice because then I can focus a little more on singing and being a front person, because that can be something very challenging for myself, and I think for you as well in the past, is that we're multitasking so much that...
That's why I'm not playing bass live.
Yeah, anymore. Andy used to play bass live with all of our previous projects, so...
It was also because we couldn't find a bass player.
Yeah. But, It's hard. They're hard to come by.
That's why I started playing bass in 4th grade, is because you can't find a reliable bass player in 4th grade.
Yeah, Josh and Nate.
I heard that early on. You know, if I want to get into a band, play bass. They're always looking for them.
Yeah.
I never learned how to play bass.
Yeah. It's hard, man. It's not like guitar.
It's like a drum kit and vocals.
Yeah, I've been playing guitar for like 14 years, and I still like... I can't like wrap my head around bass playing.
It's not just a bigger guitar, because you have to play it. You have to play it differently. Yeah, you know.
You also play drums, so I feel like you have the whole rhythmic side to you, which was actually when we first met a very big thing for me, was that I had never played with anybody before who was doing a rhythmic instrument like bass or drums. I only had if I played with somebody else, they either played guitar or piano or something like that. Mm-hmm. So, or just sang. So when I met you, you just like added the groove into my life, because you were just like,
oh, so shucks.
You were just like writing these groovy bass parts that just blew my mind. I'm like, how could somebody possibly come up with this? And like, and I feel like,
oh, shucks.
But bringing that mindset more, you know, over, just like that adds so much to the overall composition, having people who come from the different parts of music. Cause like, I wouldn't really be able to hear a bass part necessarily in a song. Like the first thing we ever collaborated on was, an old song of mine called Phantom. And I had played it, I guess, the night before. And Andy was like, hey, do you mind, if we do a little demo of this today, and if you're interested, like I would add like a bass part and some harmonies. And I was like, oh my God, you want to add stuff to my song. And then
of course I was like, oh my God, do you want to let me add stuff to your song? Yeah.
But it was like, I would never have thought of those parts ever. And so having somebody else's mind be able to fill in where mine left off was really cool for me.
Now you both have done a lot of collaboration, it sounds like. Mm-hmm. So collaborating with other people, what do you find like the process for actually integrating with what somebody else is bringing what you have for yourself?
So we didn't want it for a long time. Our band is actually us and the players we work with, who are dear friends of ours, are all hired musicians. It's what they do for a living.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They're all gigging musicians.
So this past record, I actually played drums on the demos and wrote and arranged a lot of the drum parts. And then Ted came in and played them well.
He's like basically the like most solid guy ever. Just nuts.
But so that was sort of the thing with it, like almost like a Steely Dan sort of situation where you have two people being like, this is how the record goes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Let's make the record now. But we're actually this month going to start working on some new material. And we're going to be collaborating with our friends, Nate Monshine of Echo Bass Production, and our friend Elliot Mosk, co-producing co-producing some new material.
And Nate's going to play drums.
Yeah, Nate's going to play drums.
He's been playing drums or bass a lot with us live, basically.
Yeah, it's awesome. We've been fortunate to make friends with someone who can play our music on bass or drums.
Yeah, very versatile.
And then we have our other drummer and our other bass player, so we can...
Oh, you've well stocked in that department.
Yeah,
phenomenal.
Yeah.
I'm
and
spoiled.
They're all wonderful people.
Yeah, they're all great hang great. And just super sweet and amazing players. So
yeah.
But that's going to be really exciting because both of those two people are... Well, first of all, I actually play with Nate in another band called Old Flame. And so I already very much admired his production and his arrangement techniques. And it's just been a blast to play together in general. And Elliot, I love his music so much and already hugely into his production styles as well. And I think that there's a lot of overlapping with all of us, all four of us, in terms of our influences and what we like in terms of sounds.
Yeah. But, we still all very much it, like we still all are going to definitely bring our own headspaces to the table, but it's nice. This is going to be the first album where we're asking other people to step in on a producer role. And we'll still be doing that too. It's going to very much be a collaborative effort there. But I guess, you know, sort of in the sense of like other people like looking at the big picture as opposed to just bringing folks in to like look at the drum part or a bass part or something.
Right. Now, this the current record, there's a very specific sound to it that it sounds like you guys really developed over a period of time. And it's just the two of you writing these songs, right? Mm-hmm. So if you're bringing other people in to help collaborate on new songs, do you anticipate the sound being different or do you anticipate the sound kind of carrying over if you're, you know, in that lead position?
I think it's still going to be recognizable. I anticipate growth. But I anticipate growth of what we've already been building.
Okay.
And it's still going to be us writing.
Yeah.
It's like the song's already written. It's more, I think, in terms of like studio arrangement and production and post-production stuff, like, it'll be really nice and refreshing, I think, for us to have some other input because you can get so caught up in your own head about these things, especially the last
so
thing we did was 2 years worth of just the two of us. And we'd occasionally ask friends, like, we'd play it for friends, be like, what are your thoughts? Or like, our parents. But...
Yeah, but this is
parents are good objective.
Well,
ours are.
Because Andy's sense, mom's a musician, and my mom in particular is very, like...
Brutally honest
music critic, but she, like... She and my dad are not musicians, but they're art appreciators and music appreciators. So like it's, and Andy's mom actually is a musician. So it's really nice to be able to have, you know, if we're like, hey, be honest, like, you know, what do you think about this? They'll
yeah,
say,
but this is still a step from that in actually, asking other people to be invested in the project in that, in a great sense.
Yeah.
Or can you just play this thing that we wrote?
Please? Yeah, but actually getting people involved in the bigger picture, like the complexity of that.
Yeah,
I think it's going to be nice. It's still definitely though. It's, you know, there isn't a different artist name for this. It's still going to be recognizably Sodada material. Yeah. But
do you worry at all about giving a little bit of that creative control to people that weren't involved in actually writing the song?
Not these two.
These two were picked very specifically.
Very, very specifically picked.
Okay. Yeah.
We wouldn't do this with just anybody, but it's like I think it requires a high level of trust. And I think that's why we haven't in the past worked with like a co-producer specifically is that, you know, Andy.
Well, their opinions are always wrong.
Yeah. well, I think that there's just, we have a high amount of respect for both of these two guys and like, just, I think we trust both of them a lot.
We have good working relationships with both of them and there's a lot of mutual respect about like our various musical endeavors. So this is not just, this is partially we want outside perspectives, and this is partially we wanted to invite these two people to come be a part of this. So it wasn't just like going through the yellow pages looking for who's producing this. These two.
That sounds very dangerous.
That does sound very dangerous. No, this was specifically two individuals we wanted to work with.
When you're writing the songs, did you have this in mind? Did you know you were going to be inviting people to collaborate on the production? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So what brought that? Why did you decide you wanted to go in that direction?
I think it was your idea.
Breadcrumbs, being sick of my own thoughts.
Okay.
admiring my friend's work.
Yeah.
Yeah. Andy does a lot of like most of the actual like heady production, like post-production work. I mean, I would say I co-produced this album with you.
Oh, for sure.
But you're the one who's actually at the
doing
computer.
It, but you're putting just as much thought and attention into it, for sure.
You work with Elliot on various like technical projects, and Nate and I already play in a band together.
And just like working on...
And now Nate plays with Sodada too.
Yeah, with having worked with Nate on Sodada stuff live, we've got a really good chemistry going and seem to get on well and be on the same page.
Yeah.
And Elliot is just an amazing artist and producer in his own right. I really, really respect his work.
I'd say he's actually an influence on us as well in some ways. It's great to be influenced by your friends. I would say there's a lot of that happening too.
For sure. But yeah, so really it was like wanting opportunities to work with these specific people. Yeah. Like just the thought that like, oh, working with these folks would be fun. Oh, cool. Here's an opportunity to do it.
Yeah.
You know, sort of in the same way that you might say to your friend, hey, let's go to a hike at that mountain sometime. It'd be fun to go on a hike sometime. Right. And this mountain is just presenting an opportunity. This was like, hey, I'd love to work on music with you sometime. Here's some songs we could.
Well, these are new singles too. We're going to hold off on making like another full length album probably for a little while and just focus on doing some singles, maybe an EP at some point. But I think that's kind of what we, the kind of workflow that we want at this time, while we kind of coming off of this wave of 2 years worth of an album that we were working on. And I'm really excited about that because I think it'll be fun to go in for a day, focus on this thing and release the thing, you know, closer than 2 years away. Something like the album was, we were like, let's give ourselves the time and space to take as much time as we need to make it perfect
and
for us.
And to, you know, make a project like that happen without any sort of label backing and just do it independently while still making a living otherwise and whatnot. It really needed that time and space. But I'm personally really excited about the singles because one of the things that was hardest with making a full record for me, especially over that amount of time, was that by the time you get to, you know, year one and a half, you've learned so much through the process. It's just a constant process of learning and growth. And so it can make it it can make it very hard to still feel like what you're about to release is representing where you are. At that time. And I actually feel really good with this record. It's like, I didn't know it was possible to finish a whole album and still be happy with it. And I am with this one. I mean, at this point, it's been a couple months and I have some notes for myself for next time. But overall though, like I would like to hear it again at some point.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like, don't ever play this music for me ever again.
It's just a lot.
Yeah.
Between like the finishing the album. Sorry.
Oh no, I'm sorry. I was just going to quickly, just to wrap up what I was saying, just it's going to be cool with singles to just like be able to make a thing and finish it still remotely at the same place in my life that I started it.
Yeah.
It's just a different thing. Not that necessarily one's better or worse, but it's just, we haven't done that in a while.
Right.
And the other thing is that, you know, when you're doing a full length album, it's more than just like making the album because like, when Andy said it's all like DIY, like we funded the whole thing. So it was like we had to record when we could make sure we could pay for the session musicians. Thankfully we didn't have to pay for like studio time, but, you know, more than that, you know, the past 6 months have been about planning this giant album release show, trying to, you know, submit things to blogs, trying to like do promotion, like making music videos. We actually had filmed 3 music videos with my dad back in December, and we still have 2 of them that we're working on, but one of them we had a deadline as we needed to finish it before the album was released, so that was a big project. And then
prepping everything for the vinyl records
and then the tour. So it was because we did an album release tour in North Carolina, which happened a couple weeks ago, but planning all of that amidst working full-time day jobs was just crazy. And being in another band that other band, Old Flame, I hadn't recorded their album, but we essentially linked up to do a duo album release show because we were like on the same timeline. So I was like involved with two projects doing this like crazy planning. So it's been nice the last couple of weeks to just be kind of like coming off of that and not really feeling like it's okay if I just like wake up and read for a little bit and don't try to do business work and whatever. So
and time off is good.
Yeah. And I mean, just also, I feel like something that was kind of rough for me, like the last year or so, was that I've been having a yearning to move forward creatively with like writing new songs. And I felt like I couldn't really allow myself to do that. I mean, I definitely had sparks of inspiration that I recorded down, you know, on my phone, but like, I haven't really allowed myself to be able to really just like let creative flow freely, you know, until now, because I couldn't. I was like, I need to put all this energy into this, finishing this album.
Yeah. It was just such a thing that like so much energy needs to be directed at a project like that to keep it happening.
Oh, bet. Yeah. It's gotta be exhausting.
It's exhausting and energizing all at once. Yeah. It's
a lot of good memories there.
Yeah. You know, I've really come to this place in music where it feels like the whole like making it thing is such a crapshoot. Mm. And from talking to folks I know who have quote unquote made it, you know, it's such a crapshoot, and there is not a single thing.
Magical equation.
No, and that's the thing is, because you know there's 101 blogs and articles online that'll tell you the things you have to do to whatever, and they're all trying to sell you something.
Right.
You know the thing, and so so for me at this point, it's actually a really big priority of mine to find joy in the process of doing it. It's like, it has to be energizing. Sure. It's tiring because it's a lot of work, but at the same time, it's really rejuvenating and energizing. And it has to be, because if it's not, then what's the point?
Well, I mean, part of working with friends and people that you know has to be kind of reinvigorating and energizing too.
Absolutely.
It certainly is. And even just like we've gotten the chance over as Sodada to work with like a few different, like, every album's had different cast of people on it, and it's been cool to like just see how our sounds evolved in various ways. And like
every album's been a bit different process too. If You Woke Me was very much like we had the songs, we rehearsed the songs, we recorded the songs.
We went live,
you know,
did
like a few overdubs we came up with here and there, but mostly it was like, you know, we have the songs, we're going to record the songs now. Mm-hmm. And then Sunshine, which is an EP we did after that with a drummer named Bram Masla. We did more like a jazz record where we had pieces of songs and ideas and had literally two rehearsals where we went, okay, I think this is going to go here and that'll go there. And we'll find some way to connect this. And then
we'll just improvise this one part.
We'll just make this up when we're recording, and then just went into the studio and spent like 2 days and made the thing.
Wow.
We added two songs at the end with Ted that emerged.
But. And then Phase was very much like, okay, we're going to record the song and then we're going to just build it up
from
there.
We're going to write the song as we record.
Yeah. It's been
cool. Except Ultraviolet.
Except Ultraviolet, because I started writing that song when I was 18 and I'm 27 now. So, but it's been cool to have different processes. And this next stuff is going to be a little different, too, in that I think it's going to be a little bit of a hybrid of all of it. And we're going to have other people thinking about it. And that's so exciting. It's so exciting.
Yeah, it's a lot of pressure. Because, like, you could just keep going on and on forever and just keep editing it or keep adding things. Like, we could have kept doing vocal takes.
Sure.
Till we died.
Well, and also, like, and it's funny because talking to other friends, it seems like it takes about three albums to realize this. But all of the records we love are made by teams.
Yeah.
None of them are made
by teams. Well, technically, we're five albums in, just not a Sodada. But I mean, that's something to be proud of. We've made five albums in 7 years. That's pretty cool.
That's more than some of the biggest bands in history made.
Yeah, and they've all been completely DIY, which I think has been kind of our biggest ethos is, you know, we owe so much to our community and to our friends, and none of this would have been able to happen if it weren't for our friends and our families and people supporting us and encouraging us. You know, so even just someone as simple as just being like, the sound, like, I listen to your album, it's amazing, and like, keep going. You know, I had a teacher of mine from Hunter who makes his own music that is a huge inspiration to us, you know, sent him our EP a couple of years ago, and he had said, keep doing what you're doing. And that alone was like hugely encouraging. And just like, you know, having so many of our friends, like just for instance, when the Ultraviolet music video came out, so many people like just shared it and just were commenting on it. And I don't know, it just really, it means so much. And just like our friends over the last few years who we've like kidnapped into, like
put up listening with us.
To be like, can you tell us how you think of our album?
Our captive audience.
Is that what all the duct tape is for?
Yeah.
yes.
It's just been.
Yeah, by like mix revision 50, you got to start using a little more tape.
yep. But like in all seriousness.
Using more tape?
Yes. I do.
Like reel-to-reel tape?
Yes,
or
I do.
A roll of tape?
In all seriousness, though, it really...
This is why I'm not allowed to make jokes
on
stage anymore.
Yeah, that's why we keep you in the back. No, I'm just kidding. But just, I feel like just that's kind of the thing about DIY, and something that I really resonated with here in the Valley in Massachusetts is that there's so much of that going on in the air. It's really like... so beautiful. It's really such a community-based place.
Yeah.
Ranging anywhere from like the local farms, food being in the market to being, you know, there are so many DIY like music festivals happening. There's, you know, our friend Toby runs this fantastic open mic, which has featured performers on Tuesday. We played this right before we left for our tour, and it was so cool because it was packed out on a Tuesday of people coming out to support us and this other band, Diado, who was on tour from Asheville, who very kindly let us sing in their place when we were down there. It was really great to see that. And that's really generally been the vibe since we moved up here. We had actually done this like little open mic once when we were up visiting Andy's mom on vacation a year or two before we moved here, probably a year. We went to this open mic, and it was really interesting because there were all these people there who were not playing. They were just there to hear music.
Hmm.
And usually when I've had experienced open mics in the past, it was more like everybody who was there to play music.
They're just waiting for their turn.
Right. Yeah. And I'm sure there are people who are receptive and listening to people at open mics other places. But what I really noticed was like, there are so many people here who just want to go out and hear music, who just want to go out on any given night of the week and hear music. And that is so cool.
Well, it's interesting with the whole, you know, about sort of what I was saying before about, we have so many friends that are artists and musicians that it's easy to forget that not everyone does that. Is that, you know, the audience actually has a job to do at a show by being the audience.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really wonderful to live in a place where there's enough appreciation of the art, this arts, that people get that.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Well, in the last year, you know, I work in a job where I work with a lot of people who are musicians and artists, but a lot of people who are just people who love music and are just wonderful people who are incredibly supportive and have just been coming out to all of our shows. And I don't know, that feels really good to like have a community of people too now who aren't also musicians, because it can be tricky trying to
tape down and make listen to mix revision number 50.
Yeah, we're gonna be like, you know, come over, we're gonna feed you dinner under the pretense of being a nice little hangout, but really.
Yeah. So for people who are interested but haven't heard your music yet, how would you describe it?
Maybe I should go first because you're probably going to say something really weird.
I'll say it first. So for people who haven't heard our music, who want to know what kind of music we play, you can find us on iTunes and Spotify and YouTube and pretty Tidal and Amazon and everywhere else you listen to music.
Camp.
But for those who need a label, I'd say we're something between post-punk and jazz.
I would say that it's like,
tell us.
Well, so I have to do a lot of the writing, the bio and things. So I've had to do a lot of thinking about this. And I guess the most like label things I've been able to come up with is indie rock meets neo soul meets post punk. And
we're alternative.
We're alternative. But I would say, I would say like there's definitely a jazz fusion element, but it's very much indie rock.
Yeah.
So I would say, you know, like
somewhere between post punk and jazz.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Yeah, and you know, you may get a different sense from one song than from another what we are. I think part of the reason why this even exists, being called Sodada, is that we were like trying to come up with a band name that we felt fit us more.
So we made up a word on a misspelled grocery list.
Oh, is that what it is?
I was very resistant because Andy and our friend Zoe were like, any chance they got, they were like, you know, maybe the band should be called Sodada. I'd be like, no, we can come up with something better. And we were like coming up with the stupidest names for things, like the
most of them you can't say on a.
Well, with them, because they just were like, we couldn't come up with a serious band name. Everything we would come up with would just be really silly, which is like why we had even been called the Pink Tacos in the first place, was literally because we couldn't think of another band name. So we were like, this is silly. Whatever, but and kind of feminist, so whatever, but also whatever. But now we're kind of like, okay, we at this point when we were this, we're like, this isn't really fit anything we're doing, and this is just like a random, completely random name we made up in the first place. So, Sodada ultimately was because I couldn't come up with anything better, and now it's grown on me like a barnacle.
Like a fungus. It's grown on you like a fungus.
But actually, I've come to really appreciate it because of what people have been associating it with. They're either we get a lot of people associating it with Dadaism, which I'm totally okay with, because I do think that that kind of encompasses the lack of genre that I feel like we have. But also more recently, I've come to understand soldage, the Portuguese word, which is essentially encompassing a feeling of like longing. My friend Emma has that tattooed on her, and that's how I had learned of that word, and was just like, I love that association so much with this. If people want to associate that, either of those, that's totally okay. Otherwise, it's a completely made up word. Part of the reason too is like, if you search Sodada music, literally nothing else comes up besides weird videos of kids reviewing soda.
That exists.
Like, there's like a South American company.
There's
a hair salon, actually, Sodada Hair Salon, I found.
Oh, really?
Which actually looks like a really great hair salon in Florida. Maybe they'll sponsor us, Sodada Hair Salon. But
no, but it was cool to have a made-up word for a band name, though, because in a lot of, it's like, you know, I mean, you could get into some etymology of names and like where they might have come from and what different cultural contexts and what have you. But for the most part, we just treat names as just being something that it is just what it is, right? Like nobody says, hi, my name's Steve. And somebody goes, Steve, so what does your name mean? Tell me about your name.
Right.
Oh, some people are like that.
There's some people that are like everything. Yeah. We know this. But the point being, though, it's nice to have something that's just like, no, we just made it up. It's just the name.
There's no associations. And actually, a friend of mine, because I had sent her, when we were thinking about changing the name, I was like, what do you think about this? And she's like, it sounds like something I've heard before, but like nothing I've heard before. It has this familiarity to it where I'm like, where have I heard that before? But then I've also never heard anything like it. So, and I think that I really like that because I feel like our music is a little bit like that as well, where people will be like, I hear this in this music, which, you know, a lot of the time I think we're kind of similar mindsets where I usually, as an artist, I'm not super into when people are like, wow, this sounds just like this artist and this other artist and this other artist. And I'm like, thanks, I guess. But it's also really interesting to hear when people are like, I get a lot of this stuff out of it, but it's really unique, like things, I've never heard anything like it before. So I like that it calls to mind a familiarity, but that it's new.
Yeah. That's sort of like, it feels like something you might've heard before, but isn't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I know, so iTunes, Spotify, Google Play Music,
Tidal,
Bandcamp,
all the regular places.
It's everywhere. It's on all of the regular places and a bunch of the not.
You may have to look. And our website, sodadamusic.com. We do have everything.
S O D A D A M U I S C .com.
You didn't spell music right.
No, we didn't.
Did not spell music right at all.
Did I say M-U-I-S-C?
Another made-up word.
Classic.
Classic.
It's actually spelled the way music is spelled.
Okay.
Sodada is S-O-D-A-D-A.
Okay, we'll get the music part later. Thank you both so much
for taking the time.
One more great big thank you to Hannah and Andy for sharing their stories. Now make sure to visit sodadamusic.com to watch their videos, listen to their music, and of course buy all their merch. And if they happen to be playing in your area, go check it out. That again is Sodada Music, S-O-D-A-D-A-M-U-S-I-C. There was a little bit of confusion there at the end. So their album Phase is currently available on iTunes, Spotify, Google, or at sodada.bandcamp.com.
All right, that's going to do it for today on Table to Stage. Until next time, keep creating.